AZAPO Online Political Education Series. We are very proud to be here today celebrating 1 year with this program. We started running this program on the 1st of May 2019 with our first guest of honor being the Honorary President of AZAPO, Comrade Cde Mosibudi Mangena. And you know, since then we have been running with this program week in and week out. And you know, we started off showing and discussing issues that pertain to Black people, only you know, having an audience from South Africa. We have since grown this platform to 27 countries. You know, seven of those being on the African continent. We are very proud of where we come from, and we are very proud of the contribution that this has, this platform has made to advancing thought leadership in the country. And I do want to acknowledge the contribution of the provincial executive leaderships of Limpopo, Eastern Cape and Gauteng, those provincial leaderships of AZAPO that enabled us to be on this platform today. Thank you very much to them. Today, we are celebrating the 43rd anniversary of the founding of the Azanian People's Organization. And with me to take through that journey is are people who have been there at the founding of the Azanian People's Organization, people who declared that the banning of the BC movement will not stop the revolution. They will, you know, those bannings will not stop the continuation of the program of Black consciousness in Azania. I have with me, you know, former presidents of the Azanian People's Organization in Comrade Nombulelo Mkefa and Comrade Khehla Mthembu. I also, you know, some of the founders of our youth movements. I know that Comrade Pule was traversing the country, establishing our youth formations, more especially the Azanian Students Movement. In the country, I also have Comrade Mmagauta Molefe, who was very instrumental in the mobilisation campaign, mobilising for the founding and formation of the Azanian People's Organization. These are the stalwarts of the Black Consciousness Movement and you are all comrades welcome to this platform. Today, we are really looking back and wise looking forward. It has been 53 years on since the Black Consciousness Movement was established in Azania. And out of that, you know, there was a very protracted campaign of struggle, you know, for the first decade of its existence that culminated in the attention, you know, that they received from the Boers to a point of, you know, wanting to destroy that action, wanting to destroy that movement, and banning all of those organizations. And, you know, a decade later, the Azanian People's Organization was then founded to continue with that program, and which is why 43 years ago, we saw the founding of the Azanian People's Organization as a continuation of that struggle, which was started 53 years ago, and which is why we are saying, you know, AZAPO is still on the march, you know, facing the challenges that confront Black people on a daily basis. And as I did indicate, we have Comrade Khehla Mthembu, Pule, Monama, Nombulelo Mkefa, and Mmagauta Molefe. They will be talking to us about everything that happened during their time and the decisions that were made and how we got to make those decisions and how we got to be where we are with a proud legacy that we carry of the Azanian People's Organization. Comrade Khehla, you were there at that period of time when you know, the movement was at its peak with all the activities in the mid-70s that culminated to, you know, the bannings of the BC movement. And you know, the imprisonment of the leadership of the BC movement, and you know, the migration of some of these comrades into exile, you know, trying to see how best to continue with our revolutionary struggle from outside the country under the repressive you know, pressure coming from the regime. Can you just you know, give us a high level overview of what was happening in the country, you know, just prior to those bannings that forced a lot of our comrades to be imprisoned, and perhaps, you know, take us you know, through that period and tell us as to the thinking and what was happening in the country at that time.
Thank you very much, Comrade Coordinator. And I would like to say good afternoon to you. And I also would like to say Amandla to my fellow panelists.
Amandla.
When you really think about that period, I think the liberation struggle as a whole was at a totally different note. Just a throwback a little bit. Black people had started to do things for themselves. Black people are starting to think for themselves. As a result, a myriad of organizations just were springing up all over. One would say in music speak, there was a crescendo of the liberation struggle that was taking place at that time. And so when the bannings came through, and as you know, the bannings came through the year that Comrade Mapetla Mohapi had died in February. Comrade Steve Biko died in September of that year. And so the people's anger was heightened. And everybody was almost at the point of saying this far and no further. Mm-hmm. And the readiness of all of us, all the people involved in the liberation struggle, was almost saying Gwanele, and mm-hmm. we're going forward. And so when the bannings came through, if you remember, there were, I think if I'm not mistaken, 17 organizations. And those organizations, not all of them, were as relevant as for you to remember now, organizations like ASECA and so on and so on. But what they represented, they were representing people across the board, because the conscientization of that period was such that it was not just confined to political activities, but each and every aspect of our lives, everything was included. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I'm just really happy that you considered my participation in developing the period of that time, because this is where we have to start to begin to write our own history, not history as, you know, people define it to be, but our own history. So
What happened? You know, the movement gets banned, and then what?
We wake up on the 19th of October. The declaration was that all organizations are banned. And still thinking about what that meant, we were told and we became aware that all leadership, just think of anybody who was anybody in leadership, was taken. And so we, the masses, were left almost rudderless without a leader. But because the conscientization was so high, there was a definite move of saying, guys, what do we do? And it really didn't take long. And I'm really saying within four days of that banning, some comrades met at a church out in Shawelo, the Lutheran church. People like Ismail Mkabela, Manke Kulu Mashangu, and a number of Catholic priests, Laibon Mabasa, and so on. And the idea was saying, guys, we are here now, we're banned, what do we do? And on that day, an organization was formed called the Soweto Action Committee. So the Soweto Action Committee, led by initially by Bisto, who was a local Catholic priest, but who immediately stepped down. And the result, Ism Kabela came through and became the head, almost the face of that organization called the Soweto Action Committee. That meeting decided that all known activists all over the country are going to be touched, are going to be encouraged, are going to be spoken to ask the question, Qua vadis, where are we going from here? And as a result, it was not a difficult effort to make sure that people are organized, because and that I've just described how angry people were, how conscientized people were. So just the word came through that there's an organization called the Soweto Action Committee. And that organization was inundated with a number of calls. There were self-organizations in areas we never thought of. There was self-organization in Cape Town, in Welkom, in Bloemfontein, in KZN. I mean, we were all faced with this issue of people saying, we cannot allow the lull that happened a decade earlier when the historical organizations were banned. We cannot allow that. So we must seize the moment, organize the people, and let's decide what do we do from here. So from that day, which one would say maybe the 21st or so of October, in 77, there was organization, there was mobilization. Everyone was an organizer. You know, it was as simple as that. If you hear.
I keep hearing that, you know, everybody was an organizer and, you know, mobilization started. And I understand, Comrade Mmagauta, you traveled the length and breadth of the country with, you know, using, you know, a Spundanyana Baki there, which was crisscrossing the country. How was that mobilization unfolding at the time?
Well, I did not travel. What happened is that we understood that there were two things that were needed. One was to mobilize people around the country and encourage them to form the action committees while we towards the conference. Secondly, we were going to need money. So because I worked in the head office, I knew some of the contacts that were funding us. So I was mandated to contact them, especially Harry Nengwesu, to say, look, we need funds. So he undertook that he will raise funds, but we must prepare people who travel all over Southern Africa to collect that money, because he was sending it to Swaziland, to Lesotho, everywhere. So we chose those people. Initially, it was Zakes Mofokeng and Mavana. Yeah. Although Mavana had a problem of passport, at some stage he was traveling with a Ciskei passport, at another time with a Transkei passport. It was very difficult for them, but they found a way to bring back the money from all those countries. So at the mobilization zone, I had this van. It was a company car because I was working for a community organization. So I donated the van. My employers didn't know that I was using taxi. Pule Monama, Mgoms, Manfred Yende, and I think Nkgotso Lengane. I don't remember others. I don't know who else they used. They're mandated to travel all the towns of South Africa and the people together to form action committees. They did that and when they came back, the tires of that car was just like a paper, you know? Wow. But they had done the work. And that process led us towards the conference. And that is why when we had the conference, it was representative and it was successful. Mm-hmm. I also want to say that at some stage, some people were also going without a mandate outside to collect money. I know of some people who got money and even bought garages with that money. We didn't know they went out and collected money. But at the same time, we had other funders in the country, and the committee was working hard to fundraise in the country. People like Bolaibon Bosemi in the organizing committee, they were also fundraising in the country to try and make the conference successful.
So this action committee that was established, it seems it had established connections with the exile group already, because my understanding is that the people that you are talking about were already in Botswana or elsewhere outside the country.
We had our people in Botswana, because I was a courier for BPC going out without documents and things so that we must get funding. So I knew some of the places where I was delivering those things. So we had our guys who were working for the post office. I would even go to the airport to make a call to Braamfontein, because we're all on the run. So I was phoning sometimes from a Pretoria public phone. I would phone Harry from Pretoria, be driven to the airport to go and make a call to give him details and for him to give us details. When he wanted to call, we'd make an appointment that I'll phone you on a particular day. And I was phoning from everywhere. The guy in the post office would say, I'll be on duty at this time. So you must go to this public phone. So I used a lot of public phones, even up to Fahrenheit.
Oh, Comrade Nombulelo, there was this mobilization campaign which was, basically swelling across the country, and it touched yourselves down in the Westerland, and you began to be, participants in this mobilization campaign. What were the topical issues that were being discussed at the time?
I think that the terrain in the Western Cape, in Cape Town, was very different from the rest of the country. And so we operated even before the BC time on the basis of trying to get Black people, and more particularly our so-called colored brothers and sisters, to get to see themselves as part of having to try and mobilize for change. Mm-hmm. And so that was one of the biggest things, where because of the way things were in this area, particularly where the so-called colored communities and the privileges that they were receiving as second-class citizens, it was difficult to get that kind of buy-in from them in terms of the tenets of Black consciousness and also that they are Black by definition, political definition, because they saw themselves, I always say that was, they saw themselves more as amper bas as opposed to amper kafir. You know, so it was an uphill battle. And so those in those communities, in a sense, were a handful, and we were able to create a number of cells in the various communities. So that was the first layer. The second layer, obviously, were Black students who were studying at the local universities at Forte and UWC. So to a certain extent, the thrust then, or the base of the organization, tended to be more of people who are coming to Cape Town either to study, the Mandas and the others who came to study here in Cape Town, as opposed to a broad Cape Town base. So it was very critical for us to work across political lines, which we then did, work with unions, worked with people who were PAC and even ANC, and those who were sufficiently broad-minded to take us there. So that was the terrain in which we were operating at the time.
No, Comrade Khehla, what was, it seems to me that the thinking was happening in and around, you know, what I would call the Transvaal area, or but more particularly, you know, the Soweto area. Am I correct to say, you know, the thinking turned around the action committee and the activities that were being undertaken at the time were, you know, in Soweto or emanating from Soweto? Who were in the leadership core of that action committee, and who was driving things?
Yeah, the Soweto Action Committee was quite central, but in operation, we made sure that it was not based in Soweto only. It was really the nerve center for the rest of what was happening in the country. But the people were behind them, certainly Labon, Mabasa, Isim Kabela, the driving force being Letsatsi Mosala and Semi Klobad. And then in that organization, because Soweto Action Committee was almost like a response of the people. So we had people like Manke Kulu Mahlangu, Reverend Dima, and so on, who were part of this committee. And there was no defined number of committee, who are the committee members, but anybody who comes in and puts in his or her shoulder on the wheel was accepted. That is where people like Abu Asfat were just coming in with a very strong leadership, and from Linesia, and you know, the so-called colored areas in within Johannesburg. We really tried to be as broad as possible, because the idea was mobilizing people towards this conference. And this conference was coming in. We had no idea as to what this conference is going to ultimately achieve. So we did not go there with very clear minds of saying we are going to birth an organization, but we allowed people to come in, open-minded people to come in, and we discussed this matter openly. It was a two-day conference, and we emerged with a program. So yes, it was a Soweto Action Program led by guys like Mkabela, Mabasa, Semi Klobatla, Letsatsi Mosala, and so on. You know, all of us were involved in that. But the ultimate aim was involve as many organizations as people as possible. And we held this conference.
So, Comrade Nombulelo, at what point was a decision taken that we are not going to go underground? We are going to you know, operate as overtly as we can and continue with the program of the, you know, conscientization, the program of Black consciousness.
I think that the first conference was in a sense where most people grappled with that issue about, do we go underground? And our delegation, I remember the one I was in, we were very clear, given our experiences in the Western Cape when we were trying to mobilize the various formations here, that there was, after the 1960 movements, and therefore the banning and the exiling and the people landing in Robben Island, there was very little activity and there was this void. And so, because the more we went out to seek out, and we particularly used to go to the hostels, remember, I used to go to the hostels to seek out, for example, the PAC leaders, and the response one was getting was, hey, we are listed people. How old were you in 1960? The Boers are this, the Boers. So we were trying to avoid that kind of vacuum. So that was for us one of the key things. The second part of it was that how do we avoid what happened after the big organizations left the country or went underground? Because if we go, part of people going outside to go and train to establish a liberation movement, you need a presence within the country to prepare the masses to receive them when they're ready to come back and come in. And I think that the reason in the late 80s, when the phenomenon of the askaris appeared, it was because that kind of preparation of the populace did not happen to be able to receive them. So if somebody comes back on a mission, they go to a safe place and they can't resist not going home or sending messages, and the auntie goes like, hey, usipukona, and 1, 2, 3, you know, the people get arrested. So for us, it was very critical that this is not a time to go underground. So the discussion then evolved to a point, okay, what do we do? You know, and I was one of those who were in the group where we felt that we need to mobilize, we need to do and prepare the populace in the country as opposed to going underground.
Yeah, thanks for that. Comrade Pule, I understand you were part of the entourage that was crisscrossing the country and you know, talking to people about the importance of this conference and mobilizing these people to come to the conference. And what was the reaction that you were getting from the people as you were crisscrossing the country with those comrades that you were traveling with?
As Comrade Khehla has said, just about every organization of the Black people was banned at the time. And my specific...
I'm losing you there.
I'm saying my role was specifically to look at the youth and revive them as a result of the banning. So specifically, I would be tasked with the responsibility of reviving those youth organizations, bring them back into the new fold and sell the idea of the new. I must say the response was actually quite positive everywhere, simply because I think we were fortunate enough that we had the kind of leadership that did not accept the banning. They did not sit back and say we are banned and we will wait until somebody else. They took it upon themselves. In fact, it was a banned people who actually got together, say, we are not banned. That's that courage to say, we need not fear. We need not be afraid, because the very people who are in the forefront are the ones who are saying, they'll rather kill us. We got to do this. And we did it.
No, that was lovely to see. And now, Comrade Keth, we are at this conference. And we, you know, grew up understanding Black consciousness through SASO, through BBC, through SASM. And everything BC was South African. And you go to this conference and you emerge with this Azanian organization, and no longer a South African organization. Why the shift? What happened?
This conference took place at St. Ansgar's. St. Ansgar's in Roodepoort, next to Valkersbreit, but it was at St. Ansgar's.
Okay.
And we had representatives from all over the country, and very, very interesting people from different walks of life. I remember from Cape Town, we had people like Oscar Mpeta, who came with Cde Nombulelo, and quite a number of very prominent people who were hitherto not really linked to the Black Consciousness Movement. In Gauteng, we had people like Sydney Mufumadi and all those kind of people who were part of that conference. So it was almost, call it positively, but a potpourri of ideas and people who attended. And this was a two-day event.
Okay.
We got involved in commissions, and commissions that went right into the evening. And we were used to those kind of commissions linking up, because when you remember how, you know, what we did, BBC, SASO, commissions that would go on for days. So people were ready to grapple with the issues. People were ready to debate issues openly and so on. I would say then Azania, the name Azania, won the order of the day, because the lobby that came through was that, hey guys, we are at this stage of our development in our country that we need to take the leadership ourselves. We need to start renaming this country the way we know it as, not as the way it was described as a direction somewhere in Africa, south of Africa. So it was an overwhelming authority view of saying, we better call it Azania. And George Hocop, who had really done a big research. Actually, some of the papers that AZAPO should have somewhere in the annals of their history then. It must be a paper by George Hocop, which made us understand why Azania, you know, why that word Azania. So that paper was given, and we were part of it, and we're all feeling this is the way to go. Now we are, as part of a struggle going forward, we're going to start to rename ourselves as we want to be known as, not as what other people are going to want us to be known as. So we are Azanians. We are Azanians. Therefore, we are forming an organization of the people of Azania. Therefore, this is Azanian people organization. And that's where we came in with the word AZAPO, which to many, many people, especially those who were sort of less risky, they felt that it was a serious mistake that we're doing. We're going to be attracting the wrath of the Boers, which was one. Two, we're going to be attracting the main organization, which at that time were of the historical organization, the ANC, which, as you know, never associated with the name Azania. So in some way, we were positioning ourselves as opposed to them in that word Azania. And unfortunately, some people really perceived us to be more driven towards the PAC, because the PAC used to use the word Azania. But we can safely say here, the decision was, let's decide to name ourselves as we want the whole world to know us as. And we are Azanians, let's go forward.
Do you still remember who sponsored the name Azanian People's Organization?
It's quite difficult to know, to mention the person, because this was a product of commissions. You know, the way we operated, it was quite difficult to know who's the individual who's pushing this work. But you'd have quite a number of people this time across various commissions who were really supporting it.
No, that's...
I wouldn't name one individual, but I would say yes, that was a major motivation in there. Some people might remember who spoke more about that, but I don't think that's the one. It's a product of one person. It could be that there must be somebody who they can remember spoke more of it.
No, it's quite interesting because, you know, in some circles you would hear people say, you know, I gave this name, I sponsored the name of Azanian People's Organization.
I can tell you that we were always a collective. It might be that some people push the name more, especially privately, but everything had to be tested through commissions. And at that time, discussions and conversations, debates were very robust. They were very honest. There was nothing that was ulterior motives as we see these days, just generally. But people were just open up and so on. So it could be, some people might be the ones who influence us, but it was a product of a discussion.
It was a product of struggle. No, thanks for that. And, you know, let's take the conversation forward a little bit. You know, the Azanian People's Organization is now established and it engages in, you know, programs of redeveloping itself and it establishes formations. I understand, you know, soon after the establishment of the Azanian People's Organization, there was, you know, the Congress of South African Students, which was launched. Why was it, you know, a Congress of South African Students instead of a Congress of Azanian Students? Do we have an understanding of why? And immediately thereafter, you know, there was the Azanian Students Organization, which was also launched by, you know, this Azanian People's Organization. Do you have any recollection, Comrade Fulemunam?
The COSAS issue also was a result of this the question of collectivism, as Comrade Khehla puts it. You okay. Find a group of people vociferously pushing for a name. Actually, more of a determined decision now when we went for AZAPO, because we now realize that we need an identity to build and protect. And yes. That is when the AZA now happened so far every time we formed organizations, particularly among the youth, which I was quite involved in.
Yes.
Yeah, but it's quite important to know, to remember that the formation of AZAPO actually gave a challenge, especially to the Congress movement, because they were not really happy with us going forward and just making sure that this is AZA. And with the banning of the organizations, many people within the Congress movement, they were thinking that now this is the time that we're going to be replacing the Black consciousness thought, because the Black consciousness thought as it was done at that time, was not incongruent with what we could really loosely call the Congress thinking, which was driven by, you know, the people, and so on. So as a result, when we formed AZAPO and when we formed the formations, the Congress people came in with lots of money and attracted quite a number of people to actually come and think with alternatively. And I would say, because I know the people who were driving COSAS, and up to now, there are still the people quite involved in the Congress movement thinking.
Okay, thank you, all right. Now, we established COSAS, we established we lose them to the Congress movement. How did that come about?
It's exactly what I'm saying.
You're saying the money issue was too big.
Yes, the money issue, no doubt about it. because we had no funding. You know, we really had to pull ourselves with our shoestrings, you know, for us to live and continue. And the Congress movement they were actually well funded. And the strategy was to go to the universities and begin to challenge the BC thinking. And okay. That is very well, I think where we noticed it for the first time in the true sense, we saw it at Wentworth, where we realized that there's a shift away from the BC thinking to the other thinking. We saw it at Wentworth. And by the time we saw it at Tufts and other universities, they had actually had well established themselves. It was a deliberate effort by the Congress movement to take over the leadership and the initiative from AZAPO.
Comrade Khehla, you know, just whilst you are on the floor, maybe you can help me, because I recall you were president at the time when there was what I call a repositioning of thought in AZAPO with regards to policy formulation and thinking, because there was a lot of discussion around you know, the economic policies of AZAPO. You know, we want to be a socialist organization. We want to be seen as this organization that is nationalist in character, but the content of our struggle is to be seen as socialist. How did that come into being? And why was there seemingly this shift and strong emphasis, you know, towards, you know, socialist thinking in AZAPO at that time? Because I, you know, if you can just help me, I suspect that thinking is what then led to what we see in the you know, document that we call the Azanian Manifesto.
Yeah, within AZAPO, when we formed ourselves, there was a lot of opposition that we seem to be stuck to what we used to call the Mafikeng Manifesto. I don't know whether you are quite acquainted with that document. The Mafikeng Manifesto was the economic manifesto produced by the Black People's Convention. And obviously BPC being a preceding us had a lot of influence on our thinking. And the Mafikeng Manifesto was based on what we called communalism, if you remember that. And communalism was a mixture of socialism and with a little bit of what Nyerere used to stand for. And but it was not a perfect kind of document that one would be talking about. But that put in a lot of influence into our thinking. And we were very fortunate that behind the scenes, we really had intellectual towers like George Okop, like Letsatsi Mosala, you know, the guys who really spend a lot of time. I mean, when you get to Mosala's house, you would see Das Kapital up to whatever, and you'll see a lot of all these books. He would never consider you a serious comrade unless you can quote from Das Kapital. And so we're comrades like those who are sort of the thinking behind policies formation and basically why socialism. As a result, I was actually reading a document. I don't know when it was, but I hope you can see it. It's sort of the AZAPO Constitution. And in this document, as early as that time, socialism was pushed to such an extent that there was very interesting definitions. And then we had issues of saying, what do we call capitalists with no capital? As you know, so we all of it was a process and a product of discussion and struggle. There was no document that came ready. Mm. All the documents were discussed, debated, and ultimately produced by us. So the thinking was more of an internal thinking. It was never really imposed. I can safely say that AZAPO has no foreign imposed kind of a deal. Actually, I'm talking about AZAPO during our time. And there was nothing really imposed, but all of it was really the thinking that was quite organic and people were participating.
That's great. You know, during that time, you then emerged with a decision that, you know, there's this thinking and then this work towards what you call the national forum. And I understand, you know, Comrade Professor Cesc Cooper was, you know, central amongst the people, you know, towards the establishment of the national forum, because he was the convener of that forum, and it was under your presidency at the time. Am I right?
Yes.
And what was the thinking of, you know, behind the national forum?
The national forum, you rightfully say that. It was really put during my time. Comrade Cesc Cooper became the convener, but we had to get the central committee to approve it. So, you know, there's always a temptation of putting projects to be belonging to people. You know, a national forum or Cesc Cooper's thing or Khehla Mthembu's thing. Fact is that we had to get an approval from the central committee. And the idea was clearly that AZAPO was there existing, but within AZAPO, there's many, or outside AZAPO, there's many organizations, community-based organizations.
Yes.
And that more or less needed some kind of direction, almost like what BPC did when they followed up with the Black community programs with BCP, but we're putting it at a different level, and it was different times. So we decided let's come up with a formation of all organizations that were roughly a community-based organization. And until, I remember one evening, Comrade Cooper and I went to Azadville, or not Azadville, Actonville in Benoni, to go and meet some activists, the Kachalia brothers, the Kachalias who are now. And what we thought was going to be a conversation, you know, to say, are you guys going to come up with us? It was for the first time when we realized that the Congress movement was dead against that particular initiative. And we were told by the Kachalia brothers that the National Forum will never see the end of day, because we are going against the notion in terms of what we're thinking. And as a result, when in reaction to the National Forum, when the UDF was formed, we were not surprised. But it was the National Forum was our way of broadening our base. We realized that we were in AZAPO, but for us to be able to be part of this nation, as we take it seriously as a liberation movement for this nation, we needed to broaden our base. And broadening our base, we realized that we needed to call ourselves into a national forum. That's really simply what we can call. Other people might recall other aspects of what I've said differently, but this is what I recall. We wanted to broaden the base of where we are. Who was part involved there can come in.
Yeah, and you were there, and you know, during that period of time when the National Forum was established, and quite interestingly, you know, something that does not resonate well with me is the fact that it was a result of the National Forum that the United Democratic Front was established. The United Democratic Front must be established?
Let's go back to the organizations that were banned. You know, Black Consciousness Movement was a unifier itself, because in the organization, we knew people who were ANC, and we also had people who were PAC. That is why when we were forming AZAPO, some people within us were against us forming AZAPO, because they thought now the Black Consciousness Movement is banned, now it must die. They must revive other organizations. People were being recruited, like Comrade Khehla said, now to join the Congress. And some people who were the Congress people were very strongly against AZAPO and its programs. That is why they were going in the branches, they were going to our, coming to our homes to recruit us. And some people, I know some people in Muletsane who were bought, they gave them money. There was a lady who always had a bag of money to say, if you join, I'll give you so much. So she was recruiting people, giving them, and that's how bad things were. So when the idea of national forum was mooted, then they saw that then we going to close for them. And they started working towards the UDF. Cde Nombulelo, I think, has a lot of experience with that, because basically UDF was strong in the Cape. But the main contention, the war between AZAPO and the Congress movement, was the inclusion of the whites, inclusion and exclusion of the whites, and the Freedom Charter. To an extent that one time when we had June 16 at Regina Mundi, the what they used to call the mass democratic movement brought in kumbis of best students and things, and they were booing black consciousness people when they it was that bad. And the people who were leading that were people who were from our movements. For instance, Obri Mokoena was there. He was with the mass democratic movement, and a lot of others who were part of the black consciousness movement before the bannings. So that is how it happened, and it even led to people being killed.
Yeah. Comrade Nombulelo, you're part of the delegation that went to see Alan Busa with the whole concept of the UDF. You proposed it to them, and they went ahead and established it without you. What happened?
I think our concept was much broader, as Mampila has, Mmagauta has outlined. But we approached Busak with the hope that, given the terrain in Cape Town and also, you know, the various communities in Cape Town that were not necessarily buying into Besi, that we would approach him almost as a bridge builder to be able to present this to people who wouldn't readily sort of take it from a BC perspective. And so, yes, we went to see Alan Busak. And I mean, we went there, we were a diverse group of people who went, the activists. There were some of them come from the trade unionist movement. Some of them, you know, had in a sense an understanding of BC and supportive and worked with us. And anyway, so we went to speak to him and shared this idea with him. And he said, oh, what a lovely idea. What a great idea. Let me pitch it to the others and to the ANC guys, and we'll see, you know, I'll get back to you. As history sort of attests, they never came back to us, and within a couple of weeks they then launched the UDF in Mitchell's Plain. He never even bothered to come back to us to say, no, we didn't buy in, we've already got something planned, or they just didn't come back to us.
And Comrade Pule, can you come in?
Yes. You know, the threat to power that AZAPO posed to the historical movement was very, very, very high, because we were able, in our youthfulness, to get to every corner of this country and get people organized. We were able to we didn't actually have that much money, by the way. Yeah. We never had that. But with the little that we had, we were able to work so hard. And to those who felt that these people who are supposed to be banned can actually react that way to the system, our power is being threatened. And I think it was all about that. It wasn't about our ideological correctness. It was more about them being shifted away from the center stage and we take over. And that they had to defend with all their might. And they did all sorts of things to exterminate whatever we try to do. Mm-hmm. And hence, the question of the UDF was not their plan. It was a reaction to what we're doing.
Mm-hmm. And it's quite interesting that you say it was a reaction to what we're doing, when in the same breath you are saying it was a culmination of decisions of the National Forum. Comrade Keith, what are you telling us?
I'm not with you. I don't understand the question, Comrade.
What I'm saying is that here is a group of coming together to establish or to sit together and converge as a national forum. And you are sitting there making decisions, and then you decide, that's what Comrade Nkondo was saying to me, you decide that it is important to establish this United Democratic Front. Or was it not the decision of the central of the National Forum to establish the United Democratic Front?
No. I think the UDF, the United Democratic Front, was a response.
Yes.
It was a response.
When they saw that the National Forum is certainly a threat and is closing up the space they were hoping to operate on, they decided to put it on a different gear because they have, they had all the resources and the funding and, being liberal as they were. So they were able to attract all kind of people. Bearing in mind that within AZAPO, generally within Black Consciousness Movement, we were still saying that's for Blacks only. And yet with the other people, I mean, then we had the Black Sesh, the white women thing. So it was sort of a more broader. So they were a reaction to the National Forum.
Now we are together. Now, we went ahead and we established these youth organizations, Kumri Pule, and we were quite central at the establishment of the youth formations. But you are also involved in the establishment of, even the labor movement. You are there at the establishment of AZAPTU, and you are there at the establishment of BAMKU. And can you just give us a picture of what was going on with the establishment of all of these formations of the peace movement?
Well, let's talk about BAMKU. BAMKU was formed as a result of our workers' orientation in the movement. Driven by none other than Ezazi Musala, who was, this Marxist through and through, to say we cannot be seen to be a people's liberation movement that does not take into account the interests of the working class. Okay. So we need to form this working class movement that associates and identifies with the Black Consciousness Movement. And so on, we went on forming those organizations, those labor movements, in order that we actually spread our wings. And that culminated into forming it was KUSA, then AZAPTU. But it was basically the thinking within the Black Consciousness Movement that said, we cannot operate in isolation of the people we claim to represent. We need to get them on board through the working class movement. And then you asked me about the youth formation. The one that is much more interesting is the Azasim one. By the way, when the trade union movement was formed, I was actually working, so it made sense for me to be a part of that.
Okay.
Then when our organization, student organization, was then taken away from us, as Comrade Khehla says, I was called upon by yours truly to say, you are going to resign from your job and you are going to form a new organization.
Oh, wow.
And at the time, there was no in the Black Consciousness Movement.
Okay.
If an instruction comes out, you've got to obey. And I obeyed accordingly. I did the same thing that I did before, crisscrossed the country, going to high schools, because Azasum was mainly, because it was an emergency. COSAS was gone, Azaso was gone. So we decided to have Azasum, which will have the high school component and the university component. So we had also two presidents, the high school president and the university president. But the response to the formation of Azasum 2 was very overwhelming.
Okay.
As you can recall, the launching of it in Tefluop was a huge success. That is now our response to what do we do to people who hijack our work? Do we fight them physically, or do we actually do what we ought to do? And we then went and we formed our own organizations, which actually even competed those that they've taken away, because the problem they had was they never had an idea of why they were formed. They couldn't understand, even interpret our policy documents. So the organizations were just there by name, but couldn't do anything, but could do much in terms of disrupting whatever we do. If you can remember the beating up of Comrade Laibon at the University of the North, you can remember the beating up of us at the University of Natal to try and organize this. It was quite terrible because they couldn't match us for debates. They couldn't match us for policy positioning. So all they could do is to beat us up. But we stood up there and formed those organizations under those difficult circumstances.
Okay. No, that's good to hear. I just want to do a track back a little bit. At the time when everything was happening, these things that you have just spoken about were happening, you know, the BCMA was also being established outside the country. And I'm really interested in understanding what the relationship was and how the discussions were unfolding between, you know, AZAPO internally and you know, the comrades who were establishing, you know, the BCMA outside. And Comrade Mkefa did indicate earlier that, you know, she was a courier, you know, speaking a lot to, you know, the prof and other people who were outside the country. Can you just relate to us, what was the relationship between AZAPO and what was AZAPO's influence in the establishment of the exiled wing?
Well, I wouldn't say much about BCMA because I was not involved in that. I was a courier before the bannings. I knew that there was relationship and movement of people going in and out, and there was that relationship. Even when I went to Germany, I was being escorted by BCMA people, and I ended up also in Zimbabwe. The reason I didn't work that much personally with BCMA was that my experience of having worked with people in exile. Because every time you are there, I would find that people want to give you instructions of what you should do in the country. And for me, the situation was different because we were sitting with the enemy here, dodging bullets and arrest every day. And they were out there supporting us. So we couldn't fight the same. So I personally was having arguments with people in exile. That was my reason. But I'm sure Khehla, Pule, and Nombulelo can talk on that. Personally, I didn't, even when BCMA called women to come to Zimbabwe, I did not go. I actually refused to go.
Comrade Khehla, can you come in?
Yes, comrade. BCMA, I saw you had a webinar on the topic. On how it was formed and so on and so on. So I think your audience more or less is up to date with how it was formed. But what I can talk about is the relationship that we had. Okay. And basically when we realized that our numbers of our people were swelling outside, we certainly encouraged the formation of BCMA. but we took a very strategic position of saying BCMA will always be seen to be different from AZAPO, and purely out of practical responsibilities. BCMA may do what they're allowed to do, being an organization that is not in, in the country yet, and so on. So in order to safeguard their program, we decided that they are a separate organization. But in terms of relationship, we were the, roughly put, they were representing the Black Consciousness Movement out there. And as a result, we were heavily involved as AZAPO, especially at Central Committee level during my time, that we actually were committed to provide leadership to BCMA. And our discussions with the comrades in Botswana, there were quite a number of people that they were interested in, and we had to make sure that we facilitate the movement of those people. What we got from the leadership from the BCMA in Botswana was that they needed reinforcement. And they needed reinforcement with towers of seniority. And amongst those that were quoted, I would say that two, three of them, they needed Tiza Mazibuko.
Yeah.
As you know, Tiza Mazibuko was a general secretary, was the last general secretary of the Black People's Convention. And they needed comrade Mosibudi Mangena.
Yeah.
And needed some other comrades. And on talking to the to the comrades that were required out there, it turned out that Tiza was not in the position of leaving the country for reasons that he explained and we understood and we supported. And on talking to Comrade Mangena, he too was not readily to go, but in terms of us discussing with him, he volunteered to say, look, I'll be able to go out there and be part and parcel of the leadership over there. And so I organized, I means, you know, the people we're working with, we organized and the facilitation for Mosibudi to leave this country. We made sure that he had the documents to leave and we just facilitated him leaving the country and over to BCMA. And our job was to deliver the leadership over that side. And it was for the BCMA to see how they integrate the leadership within their structures to make sure that it moves. So I am not in the position of talking about BCMA, but I can talk that during our leadership of AZAPO, we had very close relationship with the BCMA. We had discussions. We spent a lot of days and times in Botswana. We used to go to Botswana quite a lot and really got involved.
And which is why it would be possible to then say that there was a lot of resonance in terms of policy thinking and policy formulation between AZAPO and the BCMA. Because I mean, if you look at you know, the documents produced by the BCMA, quite similar to you know, the thinking inside the country with regards to the policy and ideas that we're filtering through. Am I right?
Yeah, no, you're quite right. And with HOCOP later meeting me, joining them and becoming part and parcel of that leadership, the concretization of our relationship became very strong. But as I said, they remained an independent organization for reasons that we all know of, and we remained an organization. But certainly we were all drinking from the same well.
You know, just as an aside, you know, something quite observable was the fact that there was this constant change of leadership in AZAPO. You know, the congresses of AZAPO were happening every year or every second year, something like that. And, you know, why was that happening? Do you have an idea? What do we put that to? Or was it because we're in struggle mode and now we are in democracy, elections mode, so there's no need to change leadership as frequently as we used to?
Yeah, you know, when you want to look at history and you look at the practices that took place in the past and want to compare them with now, some of the things you won't understand.
Exactly.
But yeah, they always say that now that it's summer, people forget how cold winter was. And so what happened, and we, part of the leadership, you never got into a leadership position with an aim of forming a career. It was it was not a career choice.
Okay.
It was just happened to be your turn to give in. It was your turn to contribute. You know, unlike today where people make serious decisions on joining organizations, especially political organizations, it's a career choice. At that time, there was really no career you can talk of. There were no benefits you can talk of. And as Mavana was told by Laibon Anish when he was asked, when he asked about when you guys want me to be the general secretary of this organization, what do you offer? And the simple question was, we offer you jail, we offer you detention, you're gonna be killed, you know. Those were the things that were being offered at that time. So when you look at why were the elections happening every year, we took over from the previous organizations that were there. You know, your SASA, your BPC, that was a norm. That every year the people hold a congress and they decide who they want to be led by this year. And as a result, you felt that there was nothing to change there. Because all of us happen to, you know, if you're a leader, we would just call you broadly that you happen to be the first amongst the equals.
Mm.
We're all equals, just happen to be the first on that particular year.
Okay.
And so the annual elections of the leadership was two things. One, most of the leaders never been finished 1 year because they would be in jail and the organization would be in disarray. So you had to make sure that for continuity purposes, that leaders are appointed and elected every year. Mm. And number two is to make sure that everybody can be a leader. Leadership is not reserved for a certain class of people. Everybody can be a leader. And effectively, this is what we did to expose as many people as possible. I mean, an example, when I got elected as president of AZAPO, and 1981 and the next term. So I found myself spending the two terms. But when I finished my second term, I got elected to be the chairman of the AZAPO Soweto branch. It was that kind of thing.
Becoming a chairman of the branch.
yes, we were a president 1 year, the next year, comrade, we think we need you in the branch. So I was elected as chairman of the Soweto branch. So there was no career orientation.
Mm.
I wouldn't say, but we see this of late, we see that a lot. And obviously things have changed. We cannot hold the people to the same kind of practice that we had during that time because of the changes that have taken place. So it was a deliberate thing to elect every year for people to make themselves available every year. And half the time, people won't finish the term because they'll be in detention or they'll be banned.
Okay. Maybe
another thing we should mention is that the spirit of voluntarism was very high. There were people who were or acting other portfolios that they were not appointed to an extent that the following year, we automatically just appoint them. I think we also have history as AZAPO. One time in a congress, a person nominated himself as a president. That's the kind of
I don't remember that, but
about the 43rd anniversary. This is the 43rd anniversary of the Azanian People's Organization, and we are really doing a trace back, and we are tracking the footpaths. you know, AZAPO is on the march facing, you know, the challenges. You know, it's been 53 years of existence of the Black Consciousness Movement in South Africa. And I'm here with the stalwarts of the Black Consciousness Movement and the founders of the Azanian People's Organization. If you do want to interact with us, you're more than welcome to raise your hand and interact with us and share a thing or two about, you know, whatever contribution you want to make about, you know, this current movement of the people. And you are also welcome to share your thoughts on the Q&A and as well as the chat, as well as on Facebook. We will attend to your comments and questions. Comrade Mmagauta Molefe, at some point you were a secretary, what do you call yourself? A secretary for youth and culture, right?
Yes.
And I am aware, it's something that you need to confirm for me. I am aware that you started what we call the Black Consciousness Week. Is that true?
We called it a Biko Week.
A Biko Week. Can you just give us a perspective on the Biko Week?
I was in the national organization, in the national executive as a secretariat for youth and culture.
Okay.
So I convened a conference for all the people in the country who were leading that portfolio in their branches, in their regions. So we held a meeting at Ntokozweni, the whole weekend meeting. That evening that we also had a fundraising dinner. The outcome of the meeting, one of the resolutions that we took on the Sunday, because it was two months or so before September, is that we were going to have what we call a Biko Week. Every year around Biko's death in September, we'll have a Biko. And that was the agreement that the leadership of that portfolio agreed on. In Soweto, we started with an open debate, because as AZAPO, we're now having these challenges. Our people were leaving the organization to go to the Congress, and some people were in the organization to disrupt us, to try and change us to believe in the Congress while they were holding portfolios. I'll mention people like Reverend Tema and Popo. Tema at that time was even, I think he was a chairperson of the branch, and Popo was his the deputy. Mm-hmm. So we opened the debate because people were saying now the time of Black consciousness has passed. We should rethink even the policy. So I opened a debate, which the media also covered, which we held for the whole week at the Y in Dubai. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then the Saturday was a big day. And that's how it started.
And that has continued. Wow.
Comrade
Pule, you want to add something?
No, except that on the culture side, I think there are two portfolios you've mentioned there. One strong thing that came out there was the question of the cultural boycott and the activities around it. We were at the forefront, despite the claims by others, of making that project attract international attention. We had to make sure that all of those people who, firstly, if they intend coming, we would actually call them to say, please don't come. If they insist, we will go and meet them and tell them not to. Yeah. If they insist, we will try something else. But we were there to make sure that this project is actually understood and embraced by all the people that we represent. The Coliseum Hall, if you can remember, some of them were using it, and we would go there and disrupt it from within. Mm-hmm. I remember one time we went there, we were with Letsatsi Mosala, and there were these cops. I don't know how they knew it well, they knew it. They saw him and Sammy. They say, Darcel. They disappeared. We remained. We were still a bit unknown at the time. We got inside there. Suddenly, the hall stinks, and the show stopped for a minute, and some people were pointing at us, and we dashed. There were amphitheater, Jawlani amphitheater. We got there, we did the same thing. So that department did a very, very good job in terms of realizing the program that it was in charge with. It was charged with. The OJs is one big, big one. In fact, they did not even complete their program, by the way.
Yes.
Because they didn't make money. People listened to us, because now the call for boycott was now sinking in the people's minds. They went to Orlando, they couldn't make it. They went to Witbank, they couldn't. In fact, after Witbank, they couldn't even go to KwaZulu-Natal and everywhere. They left. So that was the importance of that portfolio.
Yeah, and I just wanted to, yes, I was actually coming to that. Comrade Mkefa, you wanted to add something on the cultural boycott, but I think that was a very important program of AZAPO, you know, through that period, you know, the whole decade of, you know, that period was really so focused on, you know, activities around the cultural boycott.
Yeah, the OJ as a culmination, many people were detained. In the executive, the people who were left was myself, and Rata Mokgwatleng was the deputy president, and Vusi Nkumane was the secretariat for education. We were the only ones left. So we had to work with the Azasim guys we first phoned them before they came here. And then when they were here, we met at Rata's house, and then and mind you, I was due to give birth to my son, okay, that time. And I drove with this youth. We went there to have a meeting. Half of them were agreeing. The others were saying, no, they could perform and give us money. But what I want to say is that in the country, the Congress people were against us. Many people, the media, there was even a song that was called that time, where they would say, where will AZAPO be in the year 2000? Because they were saying, we are killing ourselves by not allowing the OJs. And all the things that we had planned, I think we had somebody who was working for the system amongst us, because all the things that we planned didn't happen. And that's when we thought at that concert, we're really going to go to get by, to be violent, you know, and if some of us die, it's fine. But people were arrested as they got off the trains, as they got into the taxis, and that didn't happen. But we had really planted the seed of against the concert, and when it failed, then we knew that the gods of Azania were with us. The boycott didn't start that time. A person who really started this was George Wokop during his time. He really worked. Yeah, he would even go to Durban. Every time there's an international star coming, he would go sometimes with Mputing during the days of BBC to go and talk to these people not to perform here.
Okay, thank you. No, I do want us to move towards the onslaught, because I want us to talk a bit about the onslaught. But before I do that, I want to give an opportunity to a hand. Yes, Comrade Nelvis. Let me just give him an opportunity to say something. Comrade Nelvis. Yeah, you can go ahead, Comrade
Nervous. Thank you, comrades. I must say that it is an honor to be hearing all those legends who have sacrificed and contributed so much for our movement, talking in the manner that they are doing. But I just wanted to highlight at least two historical milestones that I think the Black Consciousness Movement does not boast much about or talk much about. As far as I can remember, or as far as I know, it is only the Black Consciousness Movement in the history of the Azanian Revolution that a suspended and expelled its nation, its president in 1972, Comrade Themba Sono, right inside a conference, and then kicked him out and got Comrade Muntu Mieza to finish that conference. And I'm saying this in the light of what is happening in the country, where people find it very, very, very difficult to discipline their leaders. And then I think AZAPO repeated that with its first president, Comrade Curtis Nkondo, who was in breach of policy. I can't remember anybody else that has been able to do this other than our movement. And then the second one is that, as far as I remember, the Black Consciousness Movement is the only movement in this country that can boast to have been led by women. The first president, Comrade Motlali Pule, Ekhwari, and I understand, Comrade Nombulelo, you were also in the presidency. Of course, that was very far ago, 53 years and 43 years ago. Yeah, thank you.
No, thank you, Comrade Nervis. Comrade Mulebunam, you nominated and wanted us to have Cde as president.
And, I think, as Comrade Khehla said, the situations are different. I think our struggle is more commercial now than it was a revolution at the time. Took our policies and decisions very seriously at the time. I'll give you one example. There was an unwritten policy, and all of us abided by it. We are told go and mobilize people everywhere, even in the Shabin. But you don't wear our t-shirt in the Shabin.
Yeah.
And that was policy, and we knew if we have to go to a Shabin to mobilize, you go home, put on another a t-shirt or whatever, and you go and mobilize. Should you be found with that, it's a serious offense. Now, Comrade Nelvis is raising the question of how easy was it to actually expel a president, two presidents, by the way, well, a president and whatever it is. It's easy because we understand what we are all about. The policies are not brought to us. We develop them ourselves and accept them. When we say you are not to violate this, we actually mean it. It's not for someone down there and not for the other, like we see today, where you see that there's a policy for the downtrodden, for grassroots, and it doesn't apply to leadership. And that's basically what we're all about.
Comrade Nombulelo, you were president of AZAPO, and you were the successor in terms of women leadership at the helm to Mayor Khehla. What is your comment on what Comrade Nelvis was saying about the role of women in the struggle and at leadership level?
Yeah, I think that there are two sides to this, two aspects to the question. I think that being a woman in a liberation organization that is predominantly male, it also had its challenges and issues. And then the other side of the coin also being the fact that from a leadership perspective, you know, having to balance the various roles that you actually hold, not only within the organization itself, but within the community, and then also in your home. And so those are the things that in our society, women continue to juggle with. And so one had to learn how to use your role and your agency in terms of leveraging certain things. So that was sort of broadly. And then the second part for me personally was I also had a bigger challenge of being not based in Gauteng, close to the core of where the organization decision making was. And at the time, for example, when I was president, I had a young child. I remember when I got arrested here in Cape Town during the, in fact, when I went to the conference in 79, I had a newborn baby that I'd left behind. I remember breast pump, you know, at the conference having to expirate the milk there so that the milk doesn't dry up. And when I was in detention, it was the same. When under Section 10 and the baby was brought, I mean, he'd try and get to me with, you know, between the glass that separated us. And after a few attempts, he like just gives up and plays with his car on the ground. So there were various challenges in that way. And I think that it continues today. I think for many women in organization, irrespective of what organization it actually is, because the reality is that we are a patriarchal society predominantly, and particularly Black men. You know, so you end up having to make certain choices in terms of how do I drive this in a way that I can achieve what I want to achieve, or how is my energy best used in the circumstances? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think to a large extent it was that. And there are many sort of humorous other moments, you know, during that time. Khehla mentioned George, and I was flying in from Cape Town to a meeting, and there wasn't any money. Azapo didn't have money. So, you know, you fly the cheapest flight, and I land there at Jan Smuts. Then it was Jan Smuts, and I'm not met, you know. So you like stand there. There's no cell phones. There's no cell phones. So you know, and all the numbers you have are office numbers. So the office is closed. I can't phone family. I can't phone my family. You're like, what are you doing here? You know, type of thing. And the phone number I had was a card of a journalist that I had in my wallet. Mm. And that journalist was Henny Serfontein. And I called him, but he wasn't home. And his wife came to pick me up. And of course, by the time we hooked up and George came to fetch me, he was angry. I was now at this Afrikaner journalist. What are you doing here? And, you know, so there are some humorous moments, but the story just illustrates how we had to operate. And I'm sure, you know, Mmagauta has her own stories in terms of juggling that role of being an activist, a mother, a wife, and having kids, because you have to juggle
all of that. Yeah. No, thanks for the share. And I think we have to appreciate, you know, this multiplicity of roles when it comes to, you know, women activists, and try and elevate it so that people can begin to understand how difficult it is to be an activist and a woman at the same time. But I do want us to move to, you know, talking a bit about the onslaught, you know, the UDF is established, and, you know, soon there are confrontations between, you know, the UDF and AZAPO. And when did we begin to sense that there was a conflict that was about to arise? And how did we respond to that conversation?
Yeah, in Soweto in particular, it was very challenging. There were forces formed to attack us, to come to our homes. Yeah. I'll make an example. When I was staying at the flat, at Jabulani flat, there would be somebody mobilizing people that I must be attacked in the evening. And I also established my force to defend me. And when we check this person out, you find that he's staying in Pulukwan. He's just came here to come and eliminate me. And the days when they were taking cars, there were people going around taking cars from people. I would get boys coming from Tembisa, just coming at their flats to look for me. So it was very difficult. People were getting killed. In the end, people like Botamin Mkefa were killed. And also, I think it was PE where people were killed. I remember I was driving and listening to the news one Sunday when in the radio Bantu, they said that three people were killed. I think it was the Pepco 3, and they were killed by AZAPO people.
Yeah.
That week was a horrible week. And afterwards, when I went to PE, I was shown where the people were killed. They were showing us things that we're reading in the paper that so-and-so was put here, a tire was put, his brother was put, and then a tire was put, and they put in petrol. And we realized that we had two enemies. The enemy was the system, the enemy was the Congress people. At one time in Soweto, they chased Manfred. Some guys, Khehla knows them, they chased Manfred. Manfred ran towards Moroka police station, and the community of Rockville, knowing Manfred, came out to protect him. So when that guy was caught, he was found with a list of people that he was supposed to organize to eliminate. And Khehla was also in that list. I remember that Saturday we held a meeting in my house where we had to make a decision because Tutu was calling us to make peace. And some of us, Libo Munama and Wokoto, we said, we are not going to a peace talks. It means we must mobilize. So we had to train to defend ourselves. And for me, the most serious two things that happened is when they burned the house of the Hukop. And the other one, when they killed Ntatelingane. I can't forgive those people for those things. And then also the death of Azbat. So this black on black violence was, yes, the difference between the political organizations, but it was also sponsored. Because some of the people were supposed to be belonging to the Congress, we found that they were working for the police to light this fire between us so that we must start fighting and killing ourselves. And maybe the other thing I should mention that is why I also moved out of Soweto. And that was the reason also I took my children to Lesotho, because after what was happening at the flat, I said, maybe let me fight this war alone and not expose my children to this.
Okay, to that.
Mm-hmm.
Colonel Khehla, you wanted to come in?
Just saying, this was the darkest, real darkest period in our history. I mean, when you really want to think about it, one went through blood, through sweat, and through tears. And fact is that the Congress movement has a lot to do with the initiating of that period. There is no question about it. But it was flamed more when the system realized that there is division amongst us, and they made it worse. And it was during that time that, when my brother was killed, and in my business, and they went about saying they've got Cde Mthembu. And when they realized that they're a different Mthembu, there was just blood, I mean, tears and sweat within our families. I really pray that this matter should never really raise its ugly head again in our history. It was the worst part of our history. We lost people. And in that kind of view, I hope it was a big lesson to all of us, just broadly, in the liberation struggle. I can go on, I can tell you how many friends, brothers I lost during that time, but it won't help. My heart still is very sore. I cannot talk about this period without grieving. So I'd rather not, at least on this platform. All I'm just saying, I hope it doesn't happen again, and we should all of us be so vigilant that it doesn't happen again.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
I can't help but echo what has been said.
Yeah, it was really a very difficult moment, very, very difficult moment in the history of our struggle. And I think it's something that, you know, we wish that it never visits our country, it never visits our society. And it is a period that is always difficult to explain, and it's always difficult to reflect upon, where, you know, Black people would decide to kill other Black people in the course of, you know, struggle. You know, it's just unexplainable, but it happened. And, you know, there are times when we have to, you know, reflect on these things. And, you know, and the purpose of that reflection is to ensure that, you know, we never revisit these periods again. No, thanks for the share. Now, as we move towards, you know, the closure, I just want us to reflect a little about the discussions that were unfolding towards the Conference for Democratic Future. And some of you were involved in those discussions about the Conference for the, you know, Democratic Future. And I think we're part of those discussions. And what was happening at the time?
Yeah, the Conference for the Democratic Future. I remember it very well because this is where AZAPO, it happened, I think, 1989, is it?
Yeah, I think it was 1989, if I recall.
Yeah, 1989, I was seated in my office in my business, and I got approached by the Central Committee of AZAPO of that year, and Comrade Tumuntu, and let me not mention more names because I must just make a mistake, but I was approached by the Central Committee that they wanted me to come over and be part of a committee of the so-called CDF, because mm-hmm. they had been approached by the MDM.
Mm-hmm.
And they wanted us as the internal wing in South Africa to actually formulate a response to what was happening. As you know, there was the so-called Harare declarations and so on and so on. Just within the 15 minutes, within the 10 minutes that we have, I don't know whether one will do justice to it, but yes, I agreed. And I was given three or four comrades to support me in that role. And the comrades being Thabo Ndabeni, being Patel, and if I'm not mistaken, Mbulelo Rakwena, I hope I'm not mistaken. But yes, I was given those comrades to form part and parcel of the delegation, not delegation, but the committee that will be putting this conference together. And then the MDM, they brought in Comrade Mangaliso Mkashwa, Comrade Alan Busak, and so we formed a committee. Mm-hmm. And I think on the second that time we met, we were always getting our mandate from AZAPO. So we made AZAPO aware that we seem to suspect that these guys have an end in mind. And an end in mind is they wanted justification from the people inside the country that they support what they called the Harare Declaration. I'm taking for granted that everybody knows what the Harare Declaration is all about. But therefore, the OAU at that time had taken a view of saying, that's what they want to do, but they wanted to make sure that the people inside the country in South Africa support that deterioration, meaning where we're beginning to normalize the situation. So AZAPO went ahead and we went ahead and put this conference together. I'd never seen so much resources that were put onto a committee. And AZAPO was given a fair amount of money, lots of money to organize people. I think for the first time, I saw buses coming from all over, Western Cape, KZN, you name it. I mean, people of AZAPO. We managed to get over 600 delegates to come to that conference. AZAPO was not united in its approach in terms of what is it that they're going to do. There's a Imran Musa group, which was in Chaupe Mokwape, which took a different view from a view that was taken by Muntu, Lebons, and so on. So to cut the long story short, there was no united front from the AZAPO position as to what is it that we wanted to achieve. But from the MDM, it was very clear, they wanted the conference to move in and come up with an endorsement for the Harare Declaration. And I think when AZAPO showed some kind of dissent to that situation, ultimately we got expelled. This is a short summary. I'm not sure whether people want to add on it. There's lots that I've obviously omitted because of time.
No, I understand. Anything else to add, Mkefa, Mbulelo, Pule?
No, I think that's fine.
No, that's fine. We are moving towards the, you know, the closure, and I do want to, you know, hear your views about what you think the future holds for AZAPO. You know, we were doing a trace back for, you know, looking at, you know, the 53 years of the BC movement and the 43 years of AZAPO, and it's important that we do a bit of reflection as we close off about, you know, the future as to what it holds for us. But as we do so, Comrade Mkefa, we need to remember, you know, that, you know, we come from a very difficult past. It's been a very, very long path, you know, a path of 43 years of AZAPO's existence and a path of 53 years of the peace movement's existence in this country, and a lot happened. A lot of people died. And when we think about those moments, we can't help but, you know, feel the grief. We can't help but feel emotional about those happenings. And when you speak of the Pepco tree, I'm not sure if you do know that I am related to the Pepco tree in more ways than one. And it was so disheartening to hear of their death, and only to learn later that it was the system that killed them. System killed them brutally in that farm in Kriok. So brutally. And we have never really recovered from that. And what pains me more is that in as much as we now know that the system killed them brutally, there's never been an apology to AZAPO from the Congress movement and even from those people who are involved. And those people have never seen, you know, the door of jail. It hurts. Right, as we close, your words of wisdom.
From my side, I want to highlight that when we talk about us, the time when we were active, we were young. We were young people. When you look at the ages of Bo Seth when they went to Ireland, they were young. So we got conscientized by attending things that were organized by SASO and PPC. I'm a product of that. So somewhere we failed to recruit the youth to take over from us. To an extent that it happens that now at our ages, I'm 69, and you are expected still to be in the committee. When I was in AZAPO, elderly people, I had a car, I would pick them up to take them to a meeting. Today at my age, I'm still expected to pick up the youth to go with me to the meeting. You see the reversal. So we need to find a way that each one of us brings youth. You must have your own recruit. You must have your own person that you have mentored so that we must rebuild this organization. We need to rebuild this organization. Number two is the divisions. How are we going to heal the divisions? How are we going to forgive each other? We need to forgive each other for whatever happened and look at a bigger picture so that we rebuild this AZAPO or something else. It is a tragedy that such a big movement find itself where it is at the moment. It's a tragedy. That's very tragic.
Comrade Nombulelo.
I think that this period, the country and our politics find itself is quite seminal. And I think that we would be remiss if we don't sort of end this particular discussion with some thoughts of what does this mean? Not only for AZAPO, but just the BC movement and where its roots actually is. I remember, for example, when I spoke, I think it was at Mamukwari's commemoration, where I said that maybe the Azanian gods had a plan that we must not be in parliament. Mm-hmm. That actually we've turned our backs to what were BC basics and which was going back to the community. And that is not about vying for positions in parliament and all those kinds of things and career politicians, but how are we empowering people on the ground? And I think that a window has opened really in terms of the recent sort of court decisions around independent people who can stand as independents in the communities. Mm-hmm. And there's a part of me that says maybe part of us regrouping and building AZAPO, we don't go into the communities to canvass for people to vote for us and get in. No, we go into the community and do the work that BC did in the past and make people aware of what's happening in the environment and that they can actually put up their community representatives to represent them. And from that kind of activism, the same thing is going to happen as happened in Ginsburg, where after all that work and on the ground, working with the people, not necessarily recruiting people, that in the end, people are going to say, who are these people?
No, thanks.
You know, who are these people that associate with us in that way?
Me? You're closing.
Yes, I think we need to be brutal with ourselves and the truth. Mm. Black consciousness was never formed in order to be owned by its leaders.
Yep.
It is actually a product that belongs to the people for which it was formed.
Yes.
We have reached a point where, in fact, it has become a company owned by some directors. Mm-hmm. We reached a point where we actually talk against certain people within the movement and actually isolating them and owning and closing ranks. This explains exactly why people are wondering whether we are still alive or dead. When people say on social media and everywhere that there is no alternative to the ANC, they're actually telling the truth. There isn't an alternative because we are not an alternative. Much as we can speak about it, we are not an alternative because an alternative is part of the people. Mm-hmm. It is not me and you sitting out there and talking big English, Marxism and so forth. People don't have water. People don't have jobs. People don't have electricity. People don't have homes. Mm-hmm. But we are sitting here and talking how you hate so-and-so, how you did not do this, that, and the other. Where do you expect people are going to go when we're busy spending time doing all of that? Mm. I have no interest in leadership. I have an interest in the liberation of our people. Yes. And so should everybody else, because the leadership of this organization belongs to the people out there, not me and you. Thank you.
Thank you. Comrade Khehla, your closing. You are muted there.
Thank you very much, comrade. My view is quite clear that AZAPO missed several steps in going forward. And for us to be able to revive who we used to be, we need to take some steps back and really ask ourselves serious questions. At the moment, as AZAPO stands now, I'm not sure, what I do not read anything they say in public. I don't see them. I do not see their leadership anywhere. So I don't know what they say. And not being an active member of AZAPO, I don't really see what they're doing. I wish they can have a leadership that is prepared to come, to go back to the roots and begin to focus on liberation. And begin to focus on really gaining power for the sake of our people. At the moment, the little groupings that exist as AZAPO, it's unfortunately it's an irrelevant, a moribund group of debaters. But then we're not seeing much going forward. And I really wish if they can go back, some of us can come back and be able to rebuild this glorious organization. Thank you.
No, thank you. Mine is to thank each and every one of you for making the time and the contribution that has enriched this history, and you have given us a run down memory lane and given us an understanding of the legacy that we hold of the Azanian People's Organization. Thank you very much for participating in this session, and thank you very much to everybody else who connected with us this afternoon. And that's where we leave it for today until we meet again this coming weekend. Thank you and goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Struggle was not red. I experienced it, being deprived, being oppressed, even confused. It's enough now, we're taking the power back, we're stronger than before.